WRLR, 98.3 FM.
What's going on again, everybody? It's Pat Voss, and this is the Golden Sports Show. Every Wednesday afternoon from 2 to 4 p.m. Central Standard Time here in Round Lake Beach, Illinois. 98.3 FM, WRLR, the voice of Lake County. Now, normally, I have Norm in. And today, I actually have my father, Ed Voss, stepping in for Norm.
Absolutely. Hey, you're not hearing Patrick or Pat talk to himself. This is his dad, Ed. It's a great pleasure to be here with you, Pat. WRLR 98.3, voice of Lake County. I'm a big fan, and I'm really happy to be here, excited for today's show. And, man, have we got a show today.
We do have a great show planned for you guys, and here's what we have. Right now, we're going to hop into some WWE news. Ed and I are going to talk about WWE, some upcoming matches, some feuds going on, and, of course, TLC, the upcoming pay-per-view this Sunday.
Sunday.
On the WWE Network. And at the bottom of the hour, at 2:30, we will have Chris Miles, the host at NBA TV in Washington, D.C. He will be joining us via the WRLR Skype hotline to talk some NCAA hoops and also some NBA.
Do these people know how lucky they are? Do they know how lucky they are to have this show on right now with the guest lineup and the topics we're going to be talking about? Do they understand?
I don't think they do. And here's the thing. I think they're not ready for the level of professionalism that is brought by you and I today.
Holy cow.
Here we go. So WWE. Let's see. What do we have feud-wise?
Well, I'll tell you, this Sunday is TLC. That, for you novices out there, is tables, ladders, and chairs. Tables, ladders, and chairs, TLC matches throughout the evening. We've got a pretty decent card. It's not a great card, but the card consists of a non-title match between The Fiend and also The Miz. That battle started when The Fiend, Bray Wyatt, has been threatening The Miz's family, wife and children. So that's been taken to another level. This is a non-title match, but it should be pretty interesting.
Absolutely. And this is the thing is even though, so this is something I notice. Miz, to stay relevant, and I will say it this way, The Miz, to stay relevant to me, has to be feuding with someone like, you know, The Fiend. Has to be feuding with an up-and-coming, you know, rebranded person like The Fiend or Bray Wyatt, for any of those who don't know who The Fiend is. But I see it like this. The Miz used to feud with Shane McMahon.
Yes.
And that family for a brief stint.
Yes.
And I think they're looking for that kind of, you have to have a hatred back and forth on screen, you know, on TV. How do we do that? Bring the person who is one of the scariest characters right now in WWE.
It's a great character.
Yeah,
it's absolutely. The Fiend is a great character. I was never a fan of Bray Wyatt. I thought Bray Wyatt was a little bit of a waste of my time. And he went away. He got in shape. And they invented this Fiend character based on Pee-wee's Playhouse. That's where The Fiend comes out of. Bray Wyatt hosts a show which is very similar to the old Pee-wee's Playhouse, and that's creepy enough as it is. But then you add this Fiend character that's fully masked. It really is working, and it's so over right now. The crowds love it. They love it. Normally, The Miz was used to put people over,
yeah.
Right? He was a great heel. He was a great bad guy. And now that he's turned good guy or face, he is basically putting over, even though Bray doesn't need to be put over, but they're looking for things for Bray Wyatt to do without having to put the title on the line.
Well, and that's the thing is after, and by the way, we recently went to a Monday Night Raw.
We did, and boy, was that a ball.
And the thing is, so when they said dark match, I figured that was going to be, and I think a lot of people figured the dark match was going to be between Seth and Bray Wyatt, or The Fiend, because that's the way it was billed.
Right.
But then you have the dark match actually happening after Monday Night Raw, where what's his name? Who is the guy that called out?
Drew McIntyre.
Drew McIntyre called out the Fiend and said, I'm not afraid of any man. Come on out, and I want a steel cage match right now. Of course, they lower the cage and got it ready.
Drew McIntyre. He's great.
So yeah, you have that dark match, and that to me is fantastic. The way that they have the Fiend set up right now, as everything goes red and it stays red. It doesn't just open up like the Undertaker, who takes a half hour to get to the ring, and then he brings the lights back up.
It's now, more by necessity than design, I think.
I think honestly, if they keep this character going. How long do you see this character going?
Well, it's going to go until it's, you know, either stopped selling shirts or until the crowd gets sick of it, right?
Right.
I don't see that happening because there's no promos, right? The Fiend doesn't have to do a promo, so there's no way to not like him because he's not going to change what he does, and he is right now indestructible, which... You know, that's another story.
Well, and this is something I think about the Fiend is like him. Well, actually, like the Fiend, something like Seth Rollins and AOP.
Oh, boy.
Is that a rebranding of the same old thing that certain fans are used to seeing? Or do you think they can take this in a direction finally that maybe feels new and fresh?
I hope that it doesn't just become a revival of the Shield. That's what I hope. Although they have AOP running around in suits. So they've started that, fighting in suits. That's the way they're going to have to end, is fighting in suits, those poor guys. You know, they're not in their old tactical garb that they used to be in with the tactical vest and so forth, which was very similar to the Shield. I hope that they don't regurgitate another Shield feel with this thing, because... Seth Rollins, like I said, I like him. Listen, he's from my hometown. I'm from the Quad Cities. I'm from Rock Island. Seth Rollins is from Davenport, Iowa. So he's a hometown show. But I hope they don't redo the Shield just because that was so great when it was happening. Now it's done. Leave it be.
Well, and the thing is, how can you revive, you know, even the regular Shield, you have, I hate to say his name, but Dean Ambrose. AKA John Moxley. Over at AEW, and that's the thing, is why... So that, to me, the original Shield had such a great connotation with it.
Chemistry?
Chemistry.
You bet.
And I think if you try to rehash that, I feel that it'll fall flat on its face.
Yeah, I think so, too. And I think the fans out there would feel the same way, and I know that I am not alone in that hope that it doesn't become that.
Yeah,
but I'll tell you what, they could do a lot with it. They could do a lot with that trio, AOP and Seth Rollins. He is the brains. They are the brawn. They can go a lot of places with that. It just and it almost feels like, this is just my opinion, it almost feels like they're setting Seth up for a slight manager role.
Oh, yeah, maybe walking away a little bit. Yeah,
maybe.
That makes sense.
I just don't know. He holds no titles right now. He holds nothing. He just turned heel, which everybody loves. There's a great opportunity for him here, and I think they need to take advantage of it.
Now, I will say he has to go to the CM Punk class of cutting a promo.
Oh, my goodness.
But, yeah, as far as a promo goes, that's something he needs to work on if that's what they're doing with him.
He's the best they have right now.
Yes.
And that's
not necessarily
who?
Kevin Owens.
Oh, no, you're right. Kevin Owens is great. I'm a huge fan, big fan of Kevin Steen, a.k.a. Kevin Owens. He is great at the mic, but I'll tell you what, that's the best they have. And when you come, I mean, both Pat and I are huge CM Punk fans.
Absolutely.
Very happy that he's back, not with the WWE. He is back on Fox with a show that's owned by Fox, basically giving him the right to talk trash about the product and not have any fear of Vince McMahon.
Right, and that's the thing is speaking of someone like CM Punk, he was absolutely right to take that Fox deal and not take a deal back with WWE, because
100%.
You have people like Seth Rollins who are basically going on Twitter and social media and saying, hey, I want to fight you. I know CM Punk, you're back in some capacity, even if you're just talking about the product and analyzing the product. But I think someone like Seth Rollins was smart enough to tweet, and I know CM Punk told him not to, but I think he was smart enough to tweet that out because he knows that Punk, like in UFC, like with Conor McGregor, even though he's had his issues out of the octagon, like CM Punk has had some issues with WWE, he knows he's a calling card. He knows he's that guy.
He is that guy. And you know, it was funny, at the show we went to at the Allstate Arena a couple of Mondays ago, at the beginning of the show, the entire roster was circling the ring, and Seth Rollins was in the middle, basically telling the entire locker room that they stunk at the last pay-per-view. It was funny because in the very beginning, as soon as the cameras turned on, well, even a little before that, the entire crowd was chanting, CM Punk, CM Punk. And Seth took it upon himself to improvise and say to the fans, hey, I tried to get him here, but he wouldn't come. He'd just rather stay in Los Angeles behind a desk and talk about change that he's too chicken to make himself. Well, Seth got in a little trouble for that one by old Vince McMahon, Vincent Kennedy. Vince was not too happy that he brought him up. But, you know, I get it. It's all, you know, we loved it. As soon as somebody recognizes the chance that the people or the universe are saying, as soon as they're recognized for that, we love it. Doesn't matter if it's good or bad.
Well, absolutely. And that's what I think. And this is something I will criticize openly Vince McMahon for doing, is not letting the product flow the way it should. If something like that other Monday Night Raw, the Monday Night Raw that you and I went to, if something like that happens, the fact that he got in trouble for that is ridiculous.
Just
to
let
me.
It flow. You're right.
Let it flow, because that the crowd reaction to it
was great.
It was absolutely great. And the booing that Seth Rollins got, and that heel like persona that he has now again. I like that about Seth, and I don't think that him teaming with AOP is anything bad.
No.
But I don't think it's going to run its course. I feel, especially under Vince, and I hate to say it, possibly Triple H, very well might run its course quick.
Well, there's only one person that matters in WWE, right? One person.
Yes.
Vincent Kennedy. That's true. You know, I'll tell you, I feel like the product is getting better, and I think it's getting better because they have the show on Fox now on Friday night, SmackDown. And there's a lot of pressure for them to make it happen, because they're getting paid a boatload of money to be on Fox. And so, the pressure's on, and I think that's good, because for so long, I mean, AEW is here, right? It's competition, and yes, there's some big stars and so forth. But I'll tell you, there's not been any competition for WWE in so long, and that's not a good thing. So I feel like this Fox issue, this Fox network for SmackDown, is really going to help them a lot.
Well, yeah, and I think, you know, having things on SmackDown that are eye-catching,
yes,
in certain ways, I'll say,
oh boy,
could definitely be a boost to that brand, because, of course, when SmackDown originally started, why did they name it SmackDown? A person like The Rock.
La 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 la.
Oh no,
sorry.
So, people that don't know what that was, let me explain. The Rock had an intro, and that's what he would do in the middle of it when he was talking. If you could smell what The Rock is cooking, and that to me is what launched that brand.
It is, absolutely. That was his term. That was his phrase.
Absolutely,
going to lay the smacketh down upon you.
Right, and you had people like the very first match. This is why it's so memorable to, I think, you and I, probably. The very first match is The Rock and Triple H, I believe, going at it for a title match.
Right.
And with HBK as the special guest referee, HBK turns on The Rock, super kicks him, and Triple H gets the title. So
HBK is Shawn Michaels.
Shawn Michaels, right, Heartbreak Kid. What I notice is that product quickly, after people like The Rock, Triple H stopped wrestling as much, HBK retires, that product in SmackDown went away very quickly.
B-show. It was absolutely the B-show. The B-minus show.
Well, yes, and if you had a show like NXT now, of course, now recently it came on TV.
It did.
But before it was just, well, now we can see these underground fighters, you know, come back up, or these wrestlers kind of make their way.
Right.
For me, that for a time made the SmackDown show a C show.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, fortunately now for the public, you can see NXT on regular television, where before then you would only be able to see it on the WWE Network.
And speaking of trying to boost SmackDown.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about an incident. I'm going to let you go ahead and take this. A little incident between Roman Reigns and a few gentlemen, including the King, yeah. Baron Corbin. Go ahead.
So at the end of Friday Night SmackDown, basically the feud right now is Baron Corbin and Roman Reigns, the big dog. Baron Corbin also had a couple of friends, being they Bobby Roode and Dolph, I can't believe you're still here, Ziggler.
Superkick, who'd you steal it from?
Superkick, who'd you steal from? Famous or who? I don't know. Anyway, what they had done is they basically beat the snot out of Roman Reigns and took him outside the ring, chained him, arms up to the ring post on the outside, so he is stretched out, arms high in the air, and proceeded for the next 5 minutes to pummel him and smash into his face and hair and body dog food. Real dog food. And it was, you know, the wet kind of dog food. So this poor guy took it for five. I mean, it was disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. Almost hard to watch. And you know me, that stuff doesn't matter. But I'll tell you what, it was hard to watch Kevin Owens get curb stomped into a cement floor, too. Even though I know that's all controlled. I know it's all right. Controlled. Folks, I'm not going to sit here and let you think that I believe in all of this happening for real. I understand what it is. But they are so good at it sometime that it looks real and uncomfortable sometimes. But that's where the feud with Corbin and Roman Reigns is taking place for TLC this Sunday night.
And that's what I'm saying is you have to have, now, obviously not everything has to be hard to watch, obviously, to make it interesting.
No.
But I have gone and watched that, by the way, recently. I watched a little clip of that, and that is, it almost feels like, and this is for anybody that obviously can't see us right now, it almost feels like a mini torture scene.
It was a little bit.
For wrestling.
It was a little bit, yeah. It was a little bit. You know, I'd rather watch the guys in the ring with the glass light tubes and the barbed wire, because I know that's supposed to be like that.
Yes.
Right? But yes. When you have somebody, and I think it was because it was so long.
Well, so when you take it to that next step, and make it that much more uncomfortable, I think that's where fans will start to pull away a little bit. And I'd wonder whose idea that was. If it was on Vince for that idea, and that was his creative idea, he needs to retool that thinking.
It may have been his creative idea, but I'm certain that it wasn't his idea for that long of time. But the refs are out there. Right? They've got the earpiece in. They know when Vince says stop it. And, you know, whatever. Maybe he's going, because, you know, right now AEW is really focusing on those types of matches. Just if you haven't seen AEW, John Moxley was just in a 45-minute hardcore match a couple weeks ago. I think it was a pay-per-view. And it was ridiculously long, and everything but the kitchen sink, my friend.
See, that's going back to a little bit of like ECW, and I think that's a good way to go. Like you said, seeing the lights being smashed or the barbed wire, but you know that's what you're signing up for, right, when you go and watch the pay-per-view or the event. And I think if they gear the, if AEW gears themselves that way in for a bit, at least for a division, maybe even.
Right.
Even like a hardcore division, that could be great for that brand.
It really could be, yes.
And what is WWE doing to answer?
Well, I think that they're doing whatever they can not to answer right now. I think that they're trying to separate themselves and grab their audience with better versions of what has worked. That's what I think. I got to tell you, I'll tell you another disturbing yet very humorous storyline that was on the other night.
Sure.
Rusev, one of my favorites, the Bavarian?
Bulgarian.
Bulgarian, Bavarian. Oh, that's Bavarian. I like the donuts, the Bavarian cream, right?
The Bavarian cream brute.
I like the Bavarian brute. Anyway, sorry. And his real wife, Lana, kayfabed their divorce on Monday Night Raw, where they signed the divorce papers. Lana is now involved with Bobby Lashley, that big brute. The guy
he missed
muscle.
Leg day.
He did miss leg day.
I can't put my arms down.
Right here on WRLR 98.3. I just wanted to do that, folks. The storyline is funny because it has completely put Rusev over. 150%. Bobby Lashley is a monster. And you know something? Lana needs to go. Goodbye. Bye-bye. Bye, Lana.
Well, yeah, because she wasn't really contributing a whole bunch. Even in the original Rusev, you know, coming over, and originally they said he was from Russia, and then they're like, well, let's change that right now because of the political points of view on that, but
right.
but they had to change that, and now they told you he's from Bulgaria because that's actually where he's from.
Right.
And then you have Lana being basically the side piece on the ring on the side of the ring, looking fancy, and that's about all she was good for. And then you have her trying to wrestle, and that didn't work out.
That was bad. That was really bad.
Awful.
Well, I'll tell you, the product has gotten better. It's gotten me revived, and I'll tell you what, if any of you folks have ever thought about going to a live event or a Monday Night Raw or anything like that at the Allstate Arena, and you've thought, well, yeah, I'm not sure, and so do it. Just do it, because you will have a ball. You will get to see what kind of money and production is put into these shows that you watch on Monday and Friday nights. It is just spectacular. They do a great job. They keep the audience going. And, you know, if even a live event, what I've heard now, the live events are not televised. And
okay.
The live events actually have a lot more interaction between the crowd and the talent. So that's something that Pat and I are going to definitely do. Next time there's an opportunity to do so is go to one of the live events that's not televised.
Absolutely, and I think that would be a nice for a house show, because I think you'll still get a good level of competition. But one thing I wanted to do before we get off air here for the bottom of the hour, and of course at the bottom of the hour when we come back, Chris Miles, host at NBA TV in D.C. area, is going to be joining us talking about NCAA basketball and NBA.
Yeah, make sure you stick around. Chris is awesome.
Absolutely. And the one thing I wanted to touch on, this weekend, Saturday, is UFC 245. It's a pay-per-view. Three title fights in the main card. You have Amanda Nunes.
Oh, my
she is fighting. Let's see. She is fighting for the bantamweight title that she has. Bantamweight title, so 135,
mm-hmm.
against Jermaine Duranemi, who took the 145 title off of Holly Holm a little while ago and then was stripped of the title for no reason because she wasn't a defending champ.
How is that going to affect her coming down to 135, do you think? Of course, it's just coming down to 135 for a second and a half while they weigh in and then...
Correct. So when they weigh in, the weight cuts are real nasty a lot of times in the lower weight divisions, and then they can bulk up throughout those last 24 hours prior to the fight, which, of course, Conor McGregor has done and other fighters have done. Again, another featherweight title fight. Max Blessed Holloway is defending his featherweight title against Alexander Volkanovski. Volkanovski.
Say that three times fast.
Right. Volkanovski is an up and comer, but he is impressive. He's an underdog. Max is 21-4. The champ is 21-4. Alexander, the opponent, is 20-1.
Ooh.
Coming into this fight.
Ooh.
So that is the co-main event. The main event, the one I'm looking forward to the most. And by the way, I have something real quick for you guys after I announce it. Kamaru Usman, the welterweight champ right now, is going to be facing off against Colby Covington, who, of course, he tries to get attention by doing the MAGA hats and everything else. And he thinks he's Conor McGregor, really. He really thinks he's Conor McGregor, and unfortunately, he's not. And he'll learn that very quickly, especially on Saturday, I have a feeling. And here's another thing before we get off of here is Colby Covington's teammates at America Top Team, the same team that Daniel Cormier, DC, is from, they are rooting against Colby Covington in this fight against Kamaru Usman because of his tactics on the mic and what he does outside of the octagon. It's not, and that's what tells you something. Conor had the whole country of Ireland
right
behind him.
Right.
And he had fans that are UFC fans behind him. Now you have a guy like Colby Covington who is trying to do the same thing. Unfortunately, not working out so much. And America Top Team is basically verbally dropping him left and right prior to Saturday.
Fail.
Absolute fail. Guys, this has been a great first half hour, great segment. We were talking. You're in studio with Ed and Pat Voss here live for the Golden Sports Show on 98.3 FM WRLR, the voice of Lake County. When we come back at the bottom of the hour, we're going to be introducing Chris Miles. That is... He is a host at NBA TV in D.C.
You've got two Vosses for one. Stick around.
WRLR. 98.3 FM.
WRLR is community radio.
I feel much more informed with what's happening today.
When we say community, we really mean it.
It's not like corporate, and it's just a good station, yeah?
We don't belong to some large corporation that makes a profit from this station.
Because I like the diversity.
And listeners won't be forced to listen to large blocks of advertising. Operations at community radio stations are made possible through grants and underwriting from companies within this area of operation. And donations, funds, and equipment, services, and time from area residents who volunteer their time to get involved.
It's as if it's my next-door neighbor talking to me, only he's on the radio instead of next door to me.
Real people just like you.
I like them. They tell it like it is.
Local focus, local news, local music, of the local people and by the local people.
It's different than the rest of the stuff I hear.
I love the show. I listen every day.
WRLR.
I can take care of myself. I can make a peanut butter sandwich. I can brush my teeth and I can give myself a bath. I can walk home alone from school. I can pick dinner from the trash behind the deli. I can watch the baby for the whole weekend. I can keep a baseball bat by my bed just in case there's trouble. Don't worry about me. I can take care of myself.
If you're in jail, who'll be there to take care of your family? Something to think about before committing a gun crime. Gun crimes hit home. This message brought to you by Project Safe Neighborhoods and the Ad Council.
Everybody, I'm Axel. WRLR 98.3 invites you to spend a fun and festive night celebrating the season with our band, Axe and the Hatchet Men. On Friday, December 13th, at the original Sundance Saloon in Mundelein, we'll be playing a set filled with rockin' holiday tunes, as well as play a mix of our own original songs, current hits, and plenty of rock and roll. This year, we're playing in support of WRLR Community Radio, where local bands like us can get their music heard and their stories told. All ages are welcome. There's a student discount and tickets will be available at the door unless sold out in advance. You can secure your advance tickets now by contacting the station at studio@wrlr.fm or at another online seller to be announced soon. So save the date, tell your friends. Come on out to the original Sundance Loon on December 13th for the Axe and the Hatchet Men holiday show and help keep WRLR on the air. Ho ho, hope to see you there. Happy holidays.
Just hear those sleigh bells jingling, ring ting tingling.
I can take care of myself. I can make a peanut butter sandwich. I can brush my teeth and I can give myself a bath. I can walk home alone from school. I can pick dinner from the trash behind the deli. I can watch the baby for the whole weekend. I can keep a baseball bat by my bed just in case there's trouble. Don't worry about me. I can take care of myself.
If you're in jail, who'll be there to take care of your family? Something to think about before committing a gun crime. Gun crimes hit home. This message brought to you by Project Safe Neighborhoods and the Ad Council.
WRLR is community radio.
I feel much more informed with what's happening today.
When we say community, we really mean it.
It's not like corporate, and it's just a good station, you know?
We don't belong to some large corporation that makes a profit from this station.
Because I like the diversity.
And listeners won't be forced to listen to large blocks of advertising. Operations at community radio stations are made possible through grants and underwriting from companies within this area of operation. And donations, funds, and equipment, services, and time from area residents who volunteer their time to get involved.
It's as if it's my next-door neighbor talking to me, only he's on the radio instead of next door to me.
Real people just like you.
I like them. They tell it like it is.
Local focus, local news, local music, of the local people and by the local people.
It's different than the rest of the stuff I hear.
I love the show. I listen every day.
WRLR.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back. It's Pat and Ed Voss sitting in studio here for the Colton Sports Show every single Wednesday. Well, not both of us, but every single Wednesday from 2
Sorry,
to 4.
Norm.
From 2 to 4 p.m. Central Standard Time, WRLR 98.3 FM, the voice of Lake County. I wanted to let everybody know we are going to be talking NCAA basketball and NBA now, but I also wanted to let you guys know that due to a scheduling conflict, Chris Miles will not be joining us. But that's okay. We can go right on. So, here's what we have. NCAA basketball. Unfortunately, there was another number one NCAA team to fall recently. Number one Louisville fell to Texas Tech, who used to be ranked, and beat them by 13 points.
That's a huge margin, especially for a number one to fall like that.
Absolutely. I think, personally, the NCAA makes it too... They hype the teams a little too much. They hype these NCAA basketball teams a little too much. Duke was number one. They lost. Kentucky, number one. They lost. Louisville's number one right now. They lost. So all these number one seeds early are losing. So there has to be something about that that maybe you don't want to put too much... and I don't say TV time, but too much emphasis on these top-tier teams, supposedly... prior to going into like the last few weeks before March Madness.
What goes into the number one ranking when the season starts? How am I ranked number one? Is it based on last year? Based on what is the criteria or the formula?
The criteria for that would be last year I ranked however high I was ranked. How did you do if you got into the tournament, obviously? How did you do in the tournament? Who did you lose to? If you lost... you know, how many, what was the point margin? There's some that they normally go, you know, they start easy and work their way to the harder decisions and try to really parse out exactly what's going on there.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. I think what you have there is you have networks trying to boost the ratings by hyping these teams before they've played. You know, it doesn't matter. Last year, you know, ABC team is top of the heap. They have most of their returning players coming back this year, and they're not as good for whatever reason. The formula's not there. The chemistry's not there. So, we're very early in the season right now.
Yes, we're 8-9 games in. We're not, you know, nobody's 20-0 right now.
And this is a 1,084 game season. Is that how it works?
1,080. It feels like it for NCAA basketball. But really what it is, I believe they play to where, I think they play like 34 games, maybe.
Is that all it is?
It's 34 or 35 games, something like that. And for NCAA, you know, that's why it matters so much when you have a team that's 27-6 or what have you. Going into March Madness, because that is going to be one of your top four ranked teams in that region.
Okay.
And going forward, normally 26 or 25 wins or more, you're going to have a great record overall, and your seating will
be
better.
You'll be seated high.
Right. And you won't have to sit through the terrible NIT tournament that is basically the redheaded stepchild of the NCAA tournament in March Madness.
I know him.
Yeah, he kind of looks like Bill Burr. Anyways.
Love that guy.
One thing I think, though, is teams like Texas Tech, who did beat a team like Louisville, I don't even know why I'm saying that. When you talk about teams like this or that, you're assuming caliber of team.
Well, I mean, you're just assuming the caliber of a team in basketball by the name Louisville.
Well, yes. That's exactly my point. So you have these, whether it's rankings or by name, when you say North Carolina,
top.
Even though they are not this season. And that's the thing, is they can always disappoint. All these other teams can disappoint and have the opportunity to do so on a grand stage. And I think that may be, for some of the young kids, maybe a little too much pressure on certain stages, because they have graduated. These great schools of recent years have graduated their top kids. And I think maybe these young kids are trying to fill these shoes.
I agree. But I'll tell you what college athletics is all about, my friend. It's about recruiting. It's about recruiting, and you're recruiting on what you've done in the past, not what you're going to do in the future. So you have Coach Krzyzewski, or Coach, what's his?
Yeah, Coach Krzyzewski, yeah.
Coach K, isn't that what they call him?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's not how you spell Krzyzewski.
No, wait, where's the K? I don't know. You have him sitting in these kids' living rooms. He's Coach K. I can't believe Coach K is in my living room, and he wants me to go to Duke.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Even though Duke may be terrible last year, the year before, next year, doesn't matter. It's Duke. It's North Carolina. It's Louisville.
Well, and that's the thing is I get the recruiting process. I get that. I just don't understand if I was I get it because I would be on a bigger stage. Yes. And that's the big thing for a lot of these recruits is I'm going to be on a big stage, on a big network. I'm going to get noticed.
Yes.
Even if we stink, or even if we are not as good as we were last year, I'm still going to get noticed.
That's true, but that's not even where it comes from. It's not coming from the kids, I want to be big. Yes, that's part of it, Pat. That's part of it. Where it's coming from is the boosters, the supporters, the friends of the program. Okay? Now, I was an unrecruited football player.
Hard to believe.
Hard to believe. Listen, I'm a huge man. Anyway, I played it at Western Illinois University.
Oh, yeah.
Unrecruited, unheralded, unknown. Anyway, the friends of the program, the boosters, the supporters that pay for everything, right? They want their schools to be high up in rankings, you know, vying for a national championship or in that world.
Right.
Because then their school is boosted high. That's where a lot of the recruiting comes from. We want you to recruit this kid, that kid, this kid, that kid. They're good, yes, but they're also going to bring focus on our school, which is what we want.
Right. So it's a marketing decision from the side of the school rather than possibly a recruit saying, I'm going to get...
Absolutely is the kid, right? The kid says, I want to go... Like, if I was any good at football, I would have wanted to go to Notre Dame, okay?
Absolutely.
But I wasn't, so I didn't have a choice. And yes, I... Western Illinois... Hey, God bless those Leathernecks. Anyway...
God bless those Leathernecks and nobody else.
Hey, take it easy over there. Don't make me. Anyway, it's going to get physical here, folks. Put them in a headlock. So the boosters. Yes, the kids say I want to go to the pro level, and the only way I'm going to do that is not go to Western Illinois. I need to go to Notre Dame or one of the big schools that are noticed. But I'll tell you what it's all about, and I don't want to get into this discussion right now. But
okay,
it's about money. It's all about money.
Absolutely. Here's another thing.
Thank you, NCAA.
who very well might pay their players here starting very soon.
I hope so.
For the likenesses and so forth.
I hope so.
Which somebody that was sitting in your chair recently is not for necessarily all the way. He's for it, but he's for it on radio. Anyways, I'm not going to get into all that. So another way that we can put focus on a team. Oh, he's going to kill me when he comes back.
Oh, I'm glad I'm not sitting in that chair.
Oh, boy. That's why I run the boards. Anyways, another way to get yourself noticed, I have realized, is beating these teams that you're not supposed to beat, like the Texas Tech versus Louisville. But here today, later tonight, we actually have a 7 p.m. game, Omaha against number 15, Arizona. Yes.
It's in Nebraska.
Yes, it's not just a steak. you also have number 5, Michigan at Illinois, U of I. And U of I has been surprising teams, a couple teams. They're 6-3 right now to start the season.
Illinois is
6-3. Michigan is 8-1.
Wow.
So
does Harbaugh coach them too?
Well, if that was the truth, then they'd lose.
I'm sorry. That was unfair and uncalled for. I'm sorry.
Well, a team like Illinois, a team like U of I, who could have a shot because they're only two games behind right now as far as win-loss record, behind a number 5 team in the nation, that tells me that, like the Texas Tech game, who when they used to be ranked, they were ranked in the top 15 teams, and if they would have stayed ranked, they could have easily, after beating Louisville, been in the top 10 with no question.
Does that smart box you're holding there tell you a line for tonight's Illinois game?
Illinois favorites.
What?
1.5 points.
Nice.
So, yeah. One score at the end of the game very well could happen.
Absolutely. I mean, that says volumes.
And for me, the Omaha, which I can't believe I'm saying this, but Omaha against Arizona 20-point favorites.
Yes.
Which means Omaha's going to win.
Or cover.
Right. Be right under there. Hey, let's win some money.
So for all you gabblers out there.
So here's what we have. Rankings right now. Louisville, this has got to change, though, actually, because it's only through week 6, and you do have Kansas as number 2, Ohio State number 3 at 9-0, Maryland as number 4 at 10-0, but I believe Maryland just lost as well. So you do have Maryland and Louisville that needs to re-rank their records. Oh. So this is not of the current week. So once this updates, Louisville will no longer be number 1, more than likely. If I'm reading this right, Ohio State University will be number 1 in the nation and be, I believe, the 4th or 5th number 1 team right now, 6 weeks into the season.
Wow. I'll tell you what, Ohio State is having a heck of a year right now.
Absolutely. And I am I know we're both, you know, Irish fans as far as football, but when we're talking, you know, any other team since you went to Western, but I didn't go to a college like that. So I'm kind of, I find myself, I want to be free to pick and choose. So I am a big Sooners fan, Oklahoma Sooners fan, and I'm also a big Ohio State fan. So when you talk about Ohio State being up there in the top 4 or 3 teams right now, and then after they update, more than likely the number 1 team in the nation, and then you have Ohio State football, the number 2 team in the nation.
We'll get to that later.
Which we will. I like that look for that school.
Oh, absolutely. I have one of my favorite professors from Western Illinois University is when he left Western, went to become a dean at Ohio State. So on Facebook all the time, it's Ohio State, you know, Buckeye, Buckeye, Buckeye. And, hey, I'm a huge fan of great sports, be it football, basketball, baseball, doesn't matter. I'm not the only team. I mean, well, we all know I'm a Notre Dame fan. I'm a Bears fan. But other than that, I love good competition. I love it. I don't care if it's my team or not. I love good competition.
Let me put it like this. The University of Illinois, and then we're going to move on to some NBA here in a second. The University of Illinois is 6-3. They share the same record with Michigan State and UNC.
Wow.
And
go Illini.
And the fun part is, though, that Michigan State and UNC are number 16 and 17 in the nation. U of I is not ranked. And yet they have the same record as these teams. Now, I get it.
Yeah, but
I
see, have nothing. They didn't do anything last year, right?
No.
No.
Absolutely not.
So they have to build into the rankings by continuing to win. And I'll tell you what, beating number 5 Michigan tonight, is that tonight?
Yes, tonight at 8 o'clock.
That would go a long way toward that.
Absolutely. And that's the thing I also wanted to say is, if you notice, a team like San Diego State, of all people, San Diego State is number 25 in the nation. They're 10-0.
And great weather.
Yeah. Right, and great weather. That is something, excuse me one second. That is something I'm looking forward to, are these teams very possibly could keep moving up. So what do you have for us? Like, what is a team that you think might be a dark horse, or somebody of the bigger teams that may be struggling right now that you're hoping makes it into the NCAA tournament later on, and a team that you would be a fan of maybe for later on?
Woogie Boogie. Okay, yeah, Woogie Boogie. I think it's University of Wisconsin Green Bay. I think their moniker is Woogie Boogie. People who know this are going, Ed, you're an idiot. That's not what it is, but I think that's what it is, or close to that. Woogie Boogie. You know who else I would like to see make it in there is Northwestern.
Northwestern would be great.
Wildcats.
Northwestern would be great to make it in.
Hey, it's Chicago's Big Ten team.
Absolutely. And by the way, there's a reason why Chris Miles couldn't call in. He just told me, and he's about to call in. He's about to call in just a minute, and we'll have him on for about 2 seconds.
He's going
to
be calling in on the hotline.
Absolutely. His wife just had a kid last night.
Oh, well, there you go.
So he is currently at the hospital.
Now that, my friends, is a professional. That, my friends, is a professional.
So, yes, congratulations to Mr. and Mrs. Miles on their newborn child last night. So I originally thought we were having technical difficulties. Apparently, it's not technical difficulties.
Well, I mean, it just depends on what technical you're talking about.
Absolutely.
Luckily, there was no difficulties, I'm hoping, with the delivery.
Oh, yeah, me as well. And this is the thing I wanted to talk about here real quick, and obviously we hope to see you back at NBA TV there in D.C. there again, Chris, here very soon. He'll be calling in here in just a second. We will extend. Actually, I'm going to do this for you guys and then the listeners. I will extend this segment just a few more minutes, get Chris on. We'll go ahead and talk. Here's what we're going to do. So NBA is something that I look forward to throughout most of the seasons. I mean, you had for a while, you had people like the Golden State Warriors who were or a team like the Golden State Warriors, rather, who were so dominant, very, very dominant. I think they could. They're tanking this year, by the way.
Yeah.
But what do we
but
feel?
But they still beat the Bulls.
But yeah, they
I'm
still
sorry.
Beat the Bulls. Well, the Bulls, as of recently, for some reason, have a. They just have it in them to blow late games. They blow late games, and that's something that I don't know. I just can't get with. They blow late games. And you know what? Let's bring on Chris. Hey, we have Chris Miles, host of NBA TV, host at NBA TV in Washington, D.C. Chris, how are you? Hey, Chris, can you hear us?
Hello, Chris?
All right, we're going to go ahead and get Chris back on the line here.
So yeah, NBA, the Golden State Warriors are you know out of the picture, and so you've got lots of other teams. I think Chris is back with us.
Absolutely, calling on the Skype line. Chris, can you hear us? All right, you know what we're going to do?
Some technical difficulties.
We are.
Here.
So what I'm going to go ahead and do. What I'm going to go ahead and do is have him call a separate line. Go ahead and what do you see for the Bulls? Why is it that they have been so terrible over the last, how many years?
20?
Absolutely.
No, I'm just kidding. Listen, the Bulls, first of all, I think their leadership is just darn right terrible. I am no basketball expert, but I'll tell you what. Watching these Bulls, it's hard to watch them. Just getting up and down the court, transitioning back onto defense is slow and clumsy. And then hearing the press conferences of the coach,
yeah,
just drive me bananas. They drive me nuts.
Well, it seems like he doesn't
know. It's
like
listening to Wayne Fonts from Detroit all over again, and it just drives me bananas.
So we're going to give this one more try, guys. Here we go. We have Chris Miles, host of NBA TV from D.C. area. Chris, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
There he is. Hey, Chris. This is Ed. This is Pat's dad. I just wanted to welcome you to the show and congratulate you on the newborn.
Oh, thank you. you know how that is. It's unexpected. So I confirmed this, and then nature happens. What are you gonna do?
I'll tell you what, you are a true professional, and we really appreciate you being on the show. I'll let Pat take this over, but it's great to meet you.
Great to meet you.
Hey, Chris, Pat, I wanted to talk to you real quick about the NBA and maybe in your area, in your neck of the woods, I guess I could say.
Nape of the neck.
Yeah, you go. a team like the Knicks or teams in the Eastern and the East Coast, what do you see as far as improvements with these teams, like the Brooklyn Nets, things like that? What are the improvements that you're looking forward to in these teams, or what are they doing already that could make them a dark horse and a playoff run contender later on?
Well, I think with the Knicks, they have to look at the Nets and see what they did with their front office. I think when you become competent in your front office, you start to believe anything is possible. And we saw that last year with another team north of the border, but east as well, the Toronto Raptors. With Masai Ujiri, they were able to build a culture. They were able to win a championship. They were able to get a guy like Kawhi Leonard, risky deal on a one-year deal.
Tremendous.
And win a title. And when you look at the Nets, the difference between the Knicks and the Nets is their front office. I mean, the culture was built in Brooklyn about 4 or 5 years ago when you kind of thought, well, they're just going to be a bad team forever. And you could see it through it. They won more games season over season for four straight years. And then they become a destination for Kyrie Irving. They rebrand their team. They move from New Jersey to Brooklyn and say, hey, we are the Nets. This is who we are. We have an identity. We want you to be a part of this. I mean, it sounds almost absurd that a guy like Kevin Durant would decide to go to Brooklyn over New York and play for the Knicks. But when you build that culture, you don't necessarily have to win a championship. You just have to show that you're trying to win one and that you can be part of something special. And I think that's what the Knicks have been able to do and the Knicks have not.
And absolutely. And that's the thing is, I think the Knicks, it comes down to me, and tell me if I'm wrong or right on this, ownership. Ownership plays a key role in upper management, plays a key role in how they produce that culture around the team. And maybe that's a big factor as to why KD went to Brooklyn.
Well, you say that, but you also have to look at what is ownership? Or, is it a situation where, like, the Washington Redskins, I mean, I know that's the NFL, but Daniel Snyder, you think, oh, he's getting in the way of whoever he hires in the front office, whoever the coach is, and then that culture permeates 20 years. But if you look at the Knicks, really the problem starts, you can go in the season of 2013. After Carmelo Anthony and the Knicks won over 50 games, then you fire your head coach, okay? Who stepped into the front office that year? You got to look at that. So it was, to me, I mean, the finger that you start to point at first is Steve Mills. Since he took over the job, I mean, again, this was a team he took over that won 50 games. And then you look at what he's done since then, the highest they finished is ninth place, and they finished worse every single season. So I think you have to look at the front office. Yeah, you can question ownership, but the Knicks have had some decent years with the Dolans as opposed to what's happened under the current leadership in that front office.
So the reason I bring up ownership in that way is because you have certain teams. You have the Bulls, obviously. Everybody knows where their Achilles heel has been for the past few years. And the Knicks as well. I think that if you don't have somebody at the top making smart decisions, I feel like that in and of itself is a trickle-down effect a lot of times for a lot of teams, whether it be NBA, NFL, MLB, whatever. I feel that there's a trickle-down effect that is happening. And speaking of the Bulls, by the way, they are the team that wants to lose. Let's see what fashion we can lose the game today. Let's see where Zach LaVine can miss the shot now. And I feel do you feel that's a trend or something they can find their way out of?
I think the issue in Chicago is whether you want to say it's the head coach, whether you want to say it's culture, whether you want to say it's leadership. I don't think it's talent. I look at that roster and think they're talented enough, but I also look at that team as not having the leadership. The roster seems to have every bit of talent that you need in the East to win more games.
You hit it right on the head. This is Ed again. You know, I was talking just a little bit earlier about Jim Boylan, and I agree with you. I think they have a lot of very good talent. I think they don't have leadership both on the bench and on the floor. They don't have anyone. And it just drives me crazy as a fan. It drives me crazy to hear Boylan do his press conferences where it's, you know, we're getting better. We're getting better. You know, we got to get better, and we're getting better. Well, stop it. Stop it. We, you know, the sports fans today, unlike any other time in history, are very knowledgeable people. We're getting better. We got to try harder one game at a time. And, you know, God willing, we'll be able to put another win on the board. That stuff doesn't work anymore, especially with this 24-hour news cycle. But anyway, I agree with you 100%. The Bulls issue is not mainly on the floor. It's off the floor. And if Jerry Reinsdorf would give a little more attention to the Bulls than the White Sox, but he doesn't seem to care about either right now, I think we would have a lot more fandom. We'd have a lot more. I mean, the games, when you go to a Bulls game right now, I think the stadium holds, I'm just going to guess a number, let's say it's 20,000. Well, the last Bulls game, there was like 12,000 people there and televised. It's just terrible. Anyway, I just wanted to put in my 4 cents.
No, I mean, that seems to be the case. You're waiting for the development of Larry Markkanen. You see it in Zach LaVine. Zach LaVine seems like a guy that's interested in making sure he gets his stats, and he's going to do that. Is he willing to do the other things that leads to win?
Well, and one thing I say, I think, is that if you don't have that leadership behind the scenes, I don't think that leadership then, obviously, like I said, trickle-down effect, doesn't transpire onto the court. Now, what do we see? Because, like you said, a team up north, the Toronto Raptors last year, who had Kawhi Leonard, and they had a team around him to say, listen, we want to play your brand of basketball right now, and he ends up leading them to an NBA title. So, yes, the Golden State Warriors were injured, and you have those injuries. Everybody healthy on Golden State. I don't think Toronto wins that title, but whatever. It's neither here nor there. We can't keep going back in the past and going, hey, if this would have happened or that would have happened. But like teams like Toronto last year, and now Kawhi's on the Clippers and LeBron James on the Lakers, and they're trying to build this team, out west, or these teams out west. Who is it that you see taking that number one seed? Would you have a number one, number two for East and West?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think that's, to me, I know we're, what, a quarter through the season now, so it starts to become a little bit clear, and I always use the caveat, if everyone remains exactly as healthy as they are now. In the East, it's going to be the Milwaukee Bucks, and they're going to run away with the regular season. They're on a mission. It's one of those things you got to think of, the Toronto Raptors being up, them being up two games to none on the Raptors. They go to overtime in that third game, and they lose that series. Then they see Toronto win the championship. You know how that is. In their minds, they think, that should have been ours. We messed up our opportunity. We could have locked up the Raptors, and we could have won a championship, let's say, if the chips fell the same exact way. So you know that the way they came out this season, playing better this year than they did last year, I mean, setting the franchise record for consecutive wins, that's just amazing to think about how good they were last season and to see that they've improved top five in offensive efficiency, top five in defensive efficiency, never really wavering from that standpoint. So I really do think the Milwaukee Bucks, as far as the regular season is concerned, is going to run away with the Eastern Conference as far as the first seed. When it comes to the postseason, I don't see a team that I like to beat them, but I can see the Celtics being able to win a series in a sense that they have, you know, three or four guys that I like in big ball games, and Kemba Walker and Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown. I think those three guys, even Gordon Hayward, I think all of those guys I could see.
Golden State, I don't think Toronto wins that title, but whatever. It's neither here nor there. We can't keep going back in the past and going, hey, if this would have happened or that would have happened. But like teams like Toronto last year, and now Kawhi's on the Clippers and LeBron James on the Lakers, and they're trying to build this team out west, or these teams out west, who is it that you see taking that number one seed? Would you have a number one, number two for East and West?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think that's, to me, I know we're, what, a quarter through the season now, so it starts to become a little bit clear, and I always use the caveat, if everyone remains exactly as healthy as they are now. In the East, it's going to be the Milwaukee Bucks, and they're going to run away with the regular season. They're on a mission. It's one of those things you got to think of, the Toronto Raptors being up, them being up two games to none on the Raptors. They go to overtime in that third game, and they lose that series. Then they see Toronto win the championship. You know how that is. In their minds, they think, that should have been ours. We messed up our opportunity. We could have locked up the Raptors, and we could have won a championship, let's say, if the chips fell the same exact way. So you know that the way they came out this season, playing better this year than they did last year, I mean, setting the franchise record for consecutive wins, that's just amazing to think about how good they were last season and to see that they've improved top five in offensive efficiency, top five in defensive efficiency, never really wavering from that standpoint. So I really do think the Milwaukee Bucks, as far as the regular season is concerned, is going to run away with the Eastern Conference as far as the first seed. When it comes to the postseason, I don't see a team that I like to beat them, but I can see the Celtics being able to win a series in the sense that they have, you know, three or four guys that I like in big ball games, and Kemba Walker and Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown. I think those three guys, even Gordon Hayward, I think all of those guys I could see performing above their regular season numbers to win a postseason series against a team like the Milwaukee Bucks. And then when you look at the Toronto Raptors and how they keep developing under Nick Nurse, remember, Dwayne Casey was the coach of the year, and now they're just as good with Kyle Lowry missing a lot of time, without Kawhi Leonard, watching Pascal Siakam turn from a guy who was pretty good to a bona fide all-star. So I think the Bucks will run away with it in the East as far as the record is concerned for number one seed. Out West, I think it's the Lakers. Mainly because they bought in on defense.
You think the Lakers get number one out there?
Yeah, they bought in on defense.
Go ahead.
No, I mean, I guess I think the follow-up that's coming is it's the Anthony Davis factor. I mean, people forget how good he is. Now, I'm also partial to him. I have one signed autographed jersey in my house. There's only one guy I wanted him from when I met him, and that was Anthony Davis when he was a rookie. I like everything about him. I like his personality. I like that defense was always the number one important thing. I like that whenever anyone questioned how tough he was, he never wavered. I was around him during that process. So I've always been partial to him, and I was happy to see him go play with LeBron James. And I think LeBron is bought in on defense. I mean, that guys like Avery Bradley and Danny Green and even Kyle Kuzma, I think it was against Utah, had, you know, four blocks and three steals. And when you get in that kind of production defensively out of guys like Kyle Kuzma, yeah, I believe in you.
So last, before we let you go here, Chris, what are your NBA Finals predictions? Who from East, who from West, and then we'll let you go.
Oof, I mean, it's still tough because I don't know if I'm sold on the Lakers beating the Clippers in the playoff series, but I think those are the two teams from out West we're going to have. I really do think that the Nuggets front office, I think they're going to make a move and change that roster a bit. So if they do that, you know, the caveat is if they make a major roster decision, I can see them. Also want to see what happens with Kevin Love. See, like, if he ends up in Philly, I think that would be a great spot for him. They need some outside shooting. Imagine him in that front court with Joel Embiid as opposed to Al Horford. But anyway, those are things that are hypothetical that can happen. So as of today, I'm going to Lakers and the Bucks. And I like the Lakers to win that series because of their experience.
Absolutely fantastic. Chris, nice. Thank you so much for joining us here on the Golden Sports Show. Chris Miles, host of NBA TV in Washington, D.C. area. Chris, congratulations again, by the way, on your newborn child.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
All right.
Well, thanks, Chris.
We'll talk to you later.
All right. Thank you.
Again, that was Chris Miles, host of NBA TV in D.C. area. This is Pat and Ed Voss. coming at you live. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in just about 60 seconds with some NCAA football and NBA NFL talk. And then at the bottom of the hour, we also have a former writer for Around the Foghorn, a fan-sided site in California. It is Steven Roederman. He is a baseball talker extraordinaire here in just a little bit. We'll see you in a minute.
Stick around.
New York-style pizzeria in Antioch at Routes 83 and 173 is another proud sponsor of WRLR Sports. Cornicione's Pizza Dough is made from scratch using a family recipe that originated in Brooklyn, New York. Their dough is proofed at least 24 hours. Cornicione's menu includes pizzas, calzones, pasta, and much more. They have dine-in, carry-out, and delivery. Their number is 224-308-1499.
Parents, did you know that high school dropouts make 42% less than graduates? Someone will have to make up that difference, and chances are, that will be you. That means paying 42% of their groceries.
Ooh, more candy.
42% of their dentist bills.
No more candy.
Even 42% of their therapy sessions.
It's all my dad's fault.
Save your money. Encourage your kids to stay in school. For help and advice, call 877-FORAKID. A message from the U.S. Army and the Ad Council.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
What's going on again, everybody? Welcome back to the top of the hour here at the Golden Sports Show. 98.3 FM WRLR, the voice of Lake County. It's Pat and Ed Voss sitting in for Norm today.
Hello. Great to be here.
Absolutely. I'm glad to have you. I mean, this is, so when they give me
glad to be had, thanks.
And pickpocket. Anyways.
Hello.
So what I wanted to say is, as far as first choice we have, outside of the regular calls that we have, I wanted to say this on air. I mean, you are definitely the first choice. I'm not trying to say that, you know, you're my father. I'm not saying it because of that. But knowing your pedigree with your radio voice and your knowledge of sports, I needed to have you on because this was going to be, even though it sounds like I'm talking to myself, this is going to be... a great show, and I knew it was going to be. I know we had some difficulties earlier, but again, congratulations to Chris Miles and his wife on their new baby that was just had last night.
Baby child, that's what it is. A new baby child.
Because yes. I forgot to ask. Anyways.
Listen, you can't have everything.
And at 3:30, Steven Roederman, former writer for Around the Foghorn, a fan-sided site out in California. I am actually currently a fan-sided writer for Cubby's Crib, the Cubs-dedicated site on fan-sided. So that's nice. I have my first piece coming out on that site at cubbyscrib.com on Friday afternoon. So that's going to be a nice little piece there about free agency and the winter meetings. So that's going to be something we're going to discuss here at the bottom of the hour. But what do you have?
You kids and your fancy worldwide interweb technical stuff. I'm the old school guy. I've got 25, almost 30 years in voiceover and radio commercials and so forth. And all this fancy stuff you got. I'll tell you what, it's a lot easier than pushing carts, though.
Absolutely. And that's the thing. And there, here, real quick, before we get into NCAA football and NFL, Norm was asking, by the way, he said, you know, I used to do radio 20 years ago, and he goes, and I'm looking for carts. I'm looking to do this. I'm so used to the older way of doing things. And I said, listen, you know, I bring notes, and I make a little note here and there as we're going along, but normally I like to freestyle after we know the subject matter. Exactly. And I bring my phone. So that's what is beautiful about technology nowadays is that you can, when you're talking NCAA football and you want to know the rankings right now and you're not going to turn around to your computer to look it up, you're going to turn to your, well, the processor in your hand, known as a cell phone, and that is going to let you know up to the date or up to the minute stats of what you want to know while you're on air. It is very, very useful.
It's just tremendous. And stations like this, WRLR. This station is a godsend, right? In the time of big conglomerates and every station sounding the same, being the same, you've got a community radio station here, the voice of Lake County, WRLR 98.3, on over the air and on the internet, on the website. This station is a godsend for all you people. So I hope that you take advantage of it and appreciate it.
Absolutely. Then very well said. One thing I wanted to get to here, NCAA football. We have the top four.
Yes.
The top four is named now.
It is. It is. We had a little slip. We got LSU number one. We've got Ohio State, the Buckeyes, number two.
O-H-I-O.
O-H-I-O. Number three is your, oh my gosh, my mind just went blank.
Clemson.
Thank you.
Clemson Tigers.
And then coming in to the bottom is Oklahoma.
Yes.
Yes, the Sooners coming in at number four. So I look at this and I understand why Ohio State got surpassed by LSU. LSU put a whooping on Georgia, and I mean a whooping, whereas Ohio State was down, I believe it was 21-7, and had to claw back. They did it very nicely, but yet they still had to claw back against who did they play? I apologize. I'm old, folks. I'm very old.
Ohio State beat Wisconsin.
That's it.
Wisconsin was up 14-0, then they were up 21-7, and they didn't score.
Yeah, that was
past
it.
That was it.
That was it. But that should have never gotten that far.
Absolutely.
Okay? So I understand how the rankings fell. I also understand how the game, on New Year's Day, you've got two of going to be the greatest games. You've got Ohio State against Clemson. Right now, Clemson's favored in that game. They're favored by 2.5, I believe. When the game came out, when the matchup came out, Ohio State was 4-point favorites. Now they are 2.5-point dogs. LSU and Oklahoma, I don't think that Oklahoma is going to put up much of a fight.
So here's the issue I have. Even though I'm a fan of Ohio State and Oklahoma, I do see those two teams, a possibility of them meeting in the national title game, only because LSU, I think, when Oklahoma's defense, like they did there late to Baylor in the championship game for Baylor and Oklahoma, if the defense gets to Joe Burrow the way they did against Baylor, even in a slight way, I feel that Joe Burrow is a great quarterback until he gets rattled.
Joe Burrow is going to be your Heisman Trophy winner. In my opinion.
And he will lose a national title game.
He's not going to lose to Oklahoma. He might lose the national title game, but he won't lose to Oklahoma because, believe me when I tell you, LSU is no Baylor Bear.
That's true.
So, again, you know, I am no expert, but if I'm an expert at anything, it's football. And LSU is a powerhouse. I hope on January, I think it's the 13th, which is the national championship game on a Monday night. I hope it's the LSU Tigers against the Ohio State Bucks.
Here's why I don't want that, because I think that when Ohio State rolls them, like they did a few years ago when they had Zeke Elliott and they rolled over Alabama, mm-hmm. who was the supposed best team in the nation. I don't want to see that again, only because I feel like I know prior to an LSU-Ohio State game what the outcome is prior. I don't know if it's Clemson or if it's Oklahoma against Ohio State. I feel like I don't know the outcome as much because they are so kind of, Clemson, we know why that would be an undecided.
Clemson's a fantastic team.
But Oklahoma has a chance to shock people. I think Oklahoma, like Notre Dame was a few years back, was that team that, yeah, we're rooting for them. Yeah, we believe in them a little. But can they really shock people and get to a national title game?
Let me ask you a question. Do you truly believe in your heart and your head that Orgeron is going to allow Oklahoma to beat his Tigers? Do you believe that? Really?
And it may be a field goal late. It may be another situation where it's a late score, whether it be a touchdown or a field goal, very late in the game, like the other year, and I have to liken it to this, where Clemson was up against the undefeated, unbeatable Alabama Roll Tide.
Yeah, that was a great game.
Here's the interesting part. 1 second left on the clock, and Clemson takes the lead late. They drive down the field, couple little missed types of interceptions could have happened.
Yeah.
Missed opportunities there by Alabama.
Right.
Allowed Clemson to get within the 10.
Yeah.
So I think that could happen with LSU and Oklahoma. It just has to fall right in the first half, I think. If the first half, if it's a, 21-7 game like it was with Ohio State and Wisconsin, I don't think Oklahoma comes back. But if it's within a touchdown at half, there's always that possibility of that interception because Oklahoma's DBs are on fire right now and they're on a roll. So that is why I think that they will set up the Oklahoma offense in good positions throughout the game against LSU.
Well, you know something? Opinions are like T-shirts. Yeah, I fooled you, didn't I?
Man, I thought we were going to get fired.
No, we're not going to get in trouble. Anyway, seriously, though, I hope the two best teams win. The two best teams right now are Ohio State and LSU. They are the two best teams. Any given Sunday, if you're talking, you know, pro football, but any given day, one team could beat another team. You have to go by what has been done, what has been... I'll tell you what, I don't know if Ohio State's going to come out of that game. I don't know if Ohio State's going to come out against Clemson. Not today. I'm talking the way that Ohio State kind of ended the season and the way that Clemson ended the season.
Right.
Now, we're still...
Which is why...
4 weeks away or whatever it is?
Yes.
From the playoff games? All the momentum that a team has at the end of a season is lost, whether good or bad, in that 3-week, 4-week time period between then and the game.
Well, and the thing is, when you said about Clemson and their winning ways, beating teams by like 40 points each game, yes, I could see why they could beat or how they could beat Ohio State.
Yeah.
But that's also then where I disagree with you that LSU is one of the top two teams. Because they're not then doing it in Clemson fashion, and I feel that Clemson...
Oh, no, but they are. Did you see what they did to Georgia? Georgia's a great team.
Against a team that in Georgia, which I don't truly believe, at least me, I don't truly believe they should have been in the top four. I think they should have just missed the playoff.
Okay, and they did.
Or I mean, they should have missed a chance to play in that championship, the SEC title game.
Yeah.
I think... LSU would have walked against anyone in that title game.
LSU's been walking on people. They have been walking on people. And I'm not a fan of one or the other. I guess I'm more of a fan of Ohio than I am of LSU. But, man, you got to respect what Ed Orgeron's doing. He's just, you know, go Tigers. You know, the guy doesn't even have a voice left, this poor guy. This poor guy needs a voice transplant. But God bless him. He is a great coach and has got a great program there.
How scary is it now, and before we go on NFL, how scary is it that there's a possibility, and because it's top four teams ranking-wise, how scary is it there's a possibility that it could be a number three versus a number four in the national title game if Clemson beats Ohio State and somehow Oklahoma gets past LSU? You have a 3-4 seed going against each other for a title game, which I don't think money-wise, except for Clemson being back in another title game,
right?
I don't think money-wise... The NCAA would like that matchup, and I think they would prefer it to be top two.
Absolutely. Because it's a lot easier to promote top one and, one versus two, in an all-out drag-out fight.
Here's the problem I have with that. If we know, as even casual fans know, that is what the NCAA would want, are we then possibly going to see calls... and officiating that turn it that way.
I can't. Well,
Is it like a missed call in that NFC championship game between the Rams and the Saints the other year? Instead of it being something like this, where LSU has a close game, all of a sudden here's a holding call late against Oklahoma, and LSU pulls it off with a last minute field goal. Who knows?
Certainly could happen. It certainly could happen. Listen, the NCAA has no boundaries. None. They are all-knowing, all-powerful. They are the Great Wizard of Oz. They are behind the curtain.
It's scary, though.
It's scary, and I would hope beyond all hope that would never happen. It's a little bit conspiracy theory, but I understand. It can happen. I just hope that it doesn't, because there is nothing in my world that is more pure than NCAA football.
Speaking of conspiracy theory, let's move on to the NFL and the Patriots.
Woohoo!
The Patriots, hey, they're caught again. They got caught again doing something, even though, of course, they will explain it here in a minute, guys. The New England Patriots were at, I believe, a Bengals-Browns game.
Last weekend.
Mm-hmm. And they...
Well, they're... So, let me clarify.
Go ahead.
It was not the New England Patriots. It was the film company that provides film to the New England Patriots. So, it was not the New England Patriots. Just letting you know.
Right. And the film company wore Patriots gear into the building.
Yes.
So... The film company that you're describing wore Patriots gear into the building with Bengals versus Browns and was recording the Bengals sideline.
It's hard to believe they did it again, isn't it?
Not at all. They've got an aging Brady who needs some help.
Oh, they're in trouble.
And I think that's why they did it. I think they had an aging quarterback in Tom Brady for the Patriots that needs a little bit of help. And they were like, well, what can we do? What can we do under our umbrella of we're doing something else, but we'll just say we're doing something else?
So I don't think it's that way at all. I think they do it every game. Not this one because of they're struggling on offense and so forth and so on. I don't believe that that's the case. I believe that they do this every single game for their next opponent. Their film crew goes to their next opponent and films their game, and they got caught filming the sidelines this time. That's
Yikes.
What I believe.
And to have an excuse like, and if it turns out that that's what they were doing, which I highly doubt it was, if it turns out that what they say they were doing there, as far as filming their high-end scouts or some BS, something about filming one of their scouting people, advanced scouts.
So you know that every NFL team does that, right? Every NFL team. So in other words, last weekend when Green Bay played, the Bears film team was up at the Green Bay game. This is commonplace, but it's not commonplace to focus your camera on the sidelines and coaches for an entire quarter, which is what they supposedly did.
Right. Not focusing on the field where the play was taking place.
But on the sidelines
where
and the
plays
staff.
Are happening, where right. the plays are being
right.
called.
Right.
So that's the thing is I understand that, and that's why I feel that there was excuses. And by the way, another thing that was brought up about the Patriots this time around was that the last time they got caught in 07, they were fined, and they forfeited the benefit of the doubt, as they called it. They were forfeiting the benefit of the doubt if it happened again.
For future,
and here we are. So... I don't think this is going to be anything good for the Patriots. I don't think that this would be we're going to get out of this. I think it is we're going to find you like we did last time.
Yep.
And
they're not going anywhere this year anyway, so it's not going to matter. It's not like they can take away, you know, playoff wins or anything like that. I don't think that they're going to have a chance at anything like that.
Well, no, I don't think so as well. And the fact that you have Pat Mahomes now back with Kansas City, you have Lamar. He's hurt again?
His hand.
Oh, my goodness. So,
Did you hear about his hand?
Yeah, that he got tackled and when he fell on it.
I mean, he said he's okay.
Yeah.
But he's still hurt. I mean, it's still sore. Lamar.
Lamar Jackson, I was going to point out for
also
Baltimore.
Hurt.
God. Hey.
He pulled a quad. But he was on a press conference yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
And they asked him. I love this kid. Love him. He was on a press conference, and they said, so, do you know when it happened? Do you know when you hurt your quad? He goes, yeah, on the play that I didn't run, and I just stood there and passed.
And that is referring to everyone talking about that scramblers don't win and that scramblers don't last and that you have to be a pocket passer and, you know, this and that and the other. But if you get hurt on a play like that and he knows, like a Michael Vick, he can use his explosiveness, then why contain the kid?
Well, he went on to say in that press conference that he feels 100% that he is going to play on, I think they play Thursday, tomorrow night, and he's ready to go.
Well, I hope he's ready to go because that's something I don't think Baltimore can't do without him.
No.
That is, he is the heart of that offense.
But they could do without him this game because they're playing, I want to think it's Cincinnati or... I'm not sure.
I'll check
it's not
it out.
A good team.
No, it is not a good team.
I'm so glad that he's, at least feeling okay because boy, is he exciting to watch. Patrick Mahomes landed on his hand very, very hard a week ago or last Sunday.
Yeah.
And was rubbing on it and, you know, grabbing at it for several minutes afterward. And his press conference was like he always is. It's football. You're going to get hurt sometime. I'm fine.
Right, and by the way, the Ravens are taking on the 5-8 Jets.
Oh, that's right, the Jets. So the Ravens could win without him, without their starting lineup. They're without anyone.
The cheerleaders are currently
the cheerleaders
in for the offensive
could
line.
Put some helmets on and take the Jets out. I just have a feeling. Actually, I got a call, and they asked me if I wanted to go ahead and...
We need a quarterback. You need to go in here. Well, I only played line. Well, yeah. We need a quarterback.
Listen, I don't hold the football. I hit people. So I had to turn him down, though.
J-E-T-S. You know what? Another four-letter word. Not going to say it. Listen.
NFL.
Yeah.
It's red hot.
Another thing I'm looking forward to, though, is the Bears game.
Oh, yes, sir.
Bears Bob game Gattail. This Sunday, yes?
Yes, sir. Sunday.
At
the first noon game the Chicago Bears have had in forever. Yeah, so here's the deal. I'm going to take this over. Oh, yeah, no problem. What I've got to say won't take that long. The beloved, the Bear Down Chicago Bears, they are my team since I was three, and I'm older than three. So here's the deal. Yes, they're three in a row. Mitch Trubisky has looked much better against the Detroit Lions and then against the Dallas Cowboys.
Yes.
I told you folks, I'm old. My mind doesn't run as quick as it used to. But they've got a large hill to climb. Come Sunday afternoon in a frozen Lambeau field where legends are born and cowards die.
Oh, they're going to either, well, this happens one way or the other. Either it's a barely a win for the Bears, almost said Cubs, barely a win for the Bears, and or a blowout by Green Bay.
It's not going to be a blowout.
You don't think Green Bay wins by 21?
I don't think so. I really don't. And
is it because of defense?
Yeah, because guess who's back on Sunday?
Talk to us.
Akeem Hicks. Back. Off of IR, although they lost Roquan Smith. They brought some kid off their practice squad that, I don't know. But listen, the defense played very well last weekend without Roquan Smith because he got hurt early in the game.
Gotcha.
Right? This week they get Akeem Hicks back. I don't think it's going to be a blowout. Do I think the Bears are going to win the game up there? No, I don't. Then they have the Chiefs. Then they have Minnesota Vikings. Even if they were to win out, if the good Lord above would shine down upon your Chicago Bears and say, okay, you're going to win in Green Bay. You're going to win against Kansas City here in Chicago. And then against Minnesota at Minnesota's home field, you're still probably not going to make the playoffs because there's too many teams that have to give you help. And so, listen, all I would like to see out of this Bears game, I'd like to see Mitch keep progressing.
Yes, absolutely.
I'd like to see him keep the confidence he had in that Dallas game. I'd like to see him keep moving, and that's really all I'm looking for because regardless of what we think, he's going to be here next year. It's the last year of his deal.
Right.
Now, this offseason, they have to decide whether they're going to give him the fifth year. And that a lot of that's going to come from these last three games.
And one thing I wanted to point out before we get off of this segment here is Super Bowl picks, possibilities for Super Bowl. Who do you think represents NFC? Who do you think represents AFC as of right now?
Right now, I've got to go with the two best teams I've seen, and that's the Baltimore Ravens against the San Francisco 49ers.
Okay, so 49ers and Ravens. I see the 49ers possibly losing in the NFC Championship game
to
maybe
who?
To maybe a team like Green Bay. I mean, maybe. Because in the rematch, instead of getting thumped like they did last time, maybe it's a lot closer matchup.
I'll tell you
in
what,
the NFC title game.
When the 49ers went down to New Orleans last weekend, into that horrible place to play, and threw almost a 50 bomb on the Saints.
Yeah.
Whew, my goodness. Jimmy Garoppolo, not only is he a good-looking guy, he's a heck of a quarterback.
He is, and I hate to say who he trained under, but, you know, he was taught by Tom Brady to, like, listen, here's how you take over games.
Best quarterback in NFL history.
Right, and so now, well, yeah, and of course I glossed over that. And so now you have Garoppolo, who I like him, and I like Lamar Jackson, and I like Pat Mahomes. And I should say junior, basically, because, of course, his father played MLB and things like that.
Right.
So I like these new age quarterbacks now trying to really take over. That's something I'm very looking forward to in the playoffs.
Last thing I'll leave this with people watch NFL football. It's the best now. It's been in so many, many years. Just don't watch the kicker. That's all I got to tell you. The kicking in this league is just unbelievably bad. NFL Bears, Sunday, noon, Green Bay, the frozen tundra. Yeah.
Absolutely. And we'll be right back at the bottom of the hour with Steven Ruderman, the former writer of Around the Foghorn in San Francisco area. He is a baseball writer and analyst extraordinaire. We're going to have him on next. You're listening to WRLR 98.3 FM, the voice of Lake County. And this is the Golden Sports Show.
Today's sports broadcast is made possible by O'Keefe Lewis and Bruno PC. Proud to sponsor another season of Lake County High School sports broadcasts on WRLR 98.3 FM. Helping home buyers, sellers, and others with real estate transactions. O'Keefe Lewis and Bruno PC can be reached 847-675-4790. Having trouble moving the ball to finish your divorce or paternity matter? Child support or maintenance payments causing trouble with your salary cap? Sue Kamen is an experienced family law attorney who can coach you through mediation or fire a pass into the end zone at trial. To make an appointment in Antioch, Huntley, or Lake Zurich with Susan E. Kamen and Associates, their number is 847-847-7354.
When I'm under, I'm weightless, floating away, and all I think about is doing it again.
Michael Swan is under the influence of his volunteer swim coach. Spending a little time coaching, he helps Michael stay off drugs. Be a coach, a mentor, a volunteer. No matter what it is, you have something to offer. Log on to helpyourcommunity.org or call 877-KIDS-313 and be an influence on the kids in your community. Brought to you by the Office of National Drug Control Policy and the Ad Council.
You're listening to 98.3 FM, WRLR LP, Round Lake, Illinois.
Welcome back. Bottom of the hour here. We are already at 3:30 from a 2-4 show.
Unbelievably fast this time has went today. I can't believe it.
Absolutely. I cannot wait for our next guest. We're going to be talking some MLB. We have winter meetings going on right now. And, of course, a few teams trying to pick up little pieces here and free agents. We have Steven Ruderman. He is a baseball analyst. He also used to write for from Around the Foghorn there, out in the San Francisco area. Steven, how you doing?
Pat, good afternoon. How you doing, man?
Good, good, good.
Welcome to the show, Steven.
Well, thank you, sir.
So, what do you have for us, Steven? What are we looking at for MLB and winter meetings? What is popping out at you, and what are some of these key signings that have happened very, very recently as of this week? What are key signings, and what does that mean for the league as a whole?
You know, this is really interesting what's going on right now, Pat. The last 2 years, there was the topic of collusion going around with the very slow free agent markets, a lot of premier guys with free agents going into the season. And suddenly this offseason, guys are getting signed to obnoxious, insane contracts really early. We saw yesterday Gerrit Cole, 9 years,
$324 million.
Not 200, $324 million. Oh, my God. Bumgarner is now going to command so much, and Bumgarner wants at least 5 years, $100 million. So, I mean, something's a little off, Pat. I mean, I don't know why the owners didn't give any of this money the last 2 years, but they're suddenly doing it again here in this offseason. Makes no sense to me.
And like that, with Bumgarner being a long-time San Francisco Giant, what is it that makes him so available, or so we want to go after him?
Yeah, why is he even available? Or
because of his postseason success. I'm not gonna lie, do I think Madison Bumgarner is a premier pitcher, a Hall of Fame pitcher? No. But he is one of the greatest postseason pitchers of all time, and we saw it in 2010, 12, 14, and 16 in the wild card game against the Mets.
Absolutely.
He's a guy that can single-handedly carry a team over the top, and the Dodgers, of all teams, want Mad Bum. And people are saying, I mean, the Dodgers are like the 90s Braves. You know, they keep choking, but they could have that one year where they finally get on top like the Braves did in 95. And Bumgarner could be the guy who does it. In all honesty, the Giants need to get rid of him because he's been around a long time. I don't think he's the same guy he once was after the dirt bike injury. His velocity now dips in the middle innings. He starts off about 93, 94, but he'll dip to about 89 to 91 around the fourth, fifth inning, second time through the lineup. And the Giants have a history of holding on to guys for nostalgia, and it's the reason we're in this mess of three straight, probably going to be four straight losing seasons next year.
Hey, and one thing I had for you, for Madison Bumgarner, and then we'll move on to a few of the other free agents, and obviously you talked about Gerrit Cole getting signed by the Yankees.
Yeah.
You also had Steven Strasburg getting picked up again by the Washington Nationals. We thought he might walk after even being the World Series MVP last year against the Houston Astros. Somebody like Madison Bumgarner, I noticed that you said 2010, 2012, 2014, and I heard wild card game of 2016. Now, remind me again, who did the San Francisco Giants lose to in the NLDS of 2016?
Your Cubbies.
Man, that's a cheap shot he just took right there. I wouldn't take that from him.
You know what, man? It was a matter of that series was a win-win for me. It was like we had won 3 in 5 years. I really wanted the Cubs to win it all. And when the Cubs beat us, I'm like, you know what? Go Cubbies.
That's why you're a true professional, Steven.
Yeah.
I, on the other hand, am not.
He's not a true professional.
I am a homer all the way with the Chicago Cubs. And in watching the San Francisco Giants, after winning the 3 in 5 years, and then going on and saying, well, it's another even number year, so they're probably going to make a deep run, and here they come. And then we about swept them in the NLDS. That is where I knew that the Cubs team that I have been watching all season, even though they had the top record in all of Major League Baseball, you still felt like the curse of the Billy Goat. It had to hit. There was something going on there. Maybe they were going to screw it up somehow. But when they almost swept your Giants that had been so successful over the last 5-6 seasons, that's when I knew we were for real. And the fact that we made a good work of and a comeback work of the L.A. Dodgers that season and then won the World Series after being down 3-1 in that year or in that series, that is where I knew they were for real. Now, of course, we know as the Cubs go along, Theo Epstein says that no one is untouchable this offseason, and are people like, not Javi Baez and Wilson Contreras, very likely not, but are people like Zobrist is going to be gone, or if not already, and you also have Bryant and Rizzo that could very well be gone. Who do you see moving and why?
I think it's going to be Bryant. The Cubs need to get younger, and they're going to probably do what the Giants really should have done in 2017 and 2018, which is do kind of a slight rebuild but remain competitive. We saw the Yankees do this in 2016. We saw the Dodgers do this in the mid-2000s. They made the playoffs in what was a rebuilding year in 2006. They brought up guys like Andre Ethier, Matt Kemp, Russell Martin, and it was supposed to be a rebuild year, but they also kept some of the old guard, Jeff Kent and others, Nomar Garciaparra, and they went to the playoffs.
Nomar.
Sorry. We're children over here. I apologize.
Oh, I am too, man. We're all juveniles, man. We're guys.
That's right.
But no, but the Cubs definitely, I mean, even if they trade, I mean, if they were to trade both Bryant and Rizzo, then they're going nowhere. But I feel like if they trade Bryant, maybe bring in some quality players for less money, then you're both you're improving your future and putting yourself in a position where you'll be at least competitive. If they trade Bryant and get a little younger, I still think the Cubs will be competitive and at least contend.
So what do you think about people like Wilson Contreras possibly leaving the team?
There's been a lot of talk on other sports radio here, especially during the winter meetings, about Wilson Contreras.
Mm-hmm.
That he might be a great trading tool.
Yeah, that would be. How old is Wilson Contreras?
Wilson is very young. Wilson, I don't know. I know he's in his 20s, and his first season, his rookie year, was 2016. So he started off his career with a World Series title.
I would love the Giants to make that kind of trade, but unfortunately, the Giants would have to give up a lot of prospects.
Absolutely, because prospect. Who are you going to give us? But like exactly. Buster Posey doesn't play for y'all anymore, does he?
No, I mean, and the Giants have Posey's replacement probably coming up at the end of next year, early 2021, and Joey Bart. And the big mistake the Giants made with Posey, and I said for years, they've got to get him out of the catching position. A friend of mine told me who was, was around the game. He said when position players will slowly decline, but catchers, they decline like that. And that's what happened to Posey in 2018. It was, if the Giants would have moved Posey to first base after 2017, when he had a good year, he could have been saved and he'd still be in his prime. But 2018, he had the surgery, his hip. And it was, even if they moved him to first base at that point, it was too late. And with Joey Bart coming up, I'd rather the Giants just move him to first base and not make the same mistake they made with Buster Posey so that Bart could have a much longer career. And so that's why I would love Wilson Contreras. But as I said earlier, I just don't think with the Giants have really improved their farm system over the last year. They went from the third worst to now 15th, which is, I mean, we're not in the top, but to turn around like that is pretty impressive. And so we still have a vulnerable farm system. We added, Will Wilson, the guy from the Angels yesterday. We got him and, who else did the Giants get from the Angels yesterday?
I'd have to check that out there. Oh, is that Cozart?
I think it may have been Cozart.
The fact that Angels, period, are willing to give up pieces after they just hire on Joe Maddon is like, okay, are you really willing to push that, or do you actually have a plan?
I think the Angels are going for in the short term, and I think they're definitely going to try and be competitive next year. As for the long term, I don't think it's a good idea. I think they might be good for a year or two, but after that, I just don't see them making much noise. I really don't.
How did everybody feel out there for the new coach, the new hire?
Gabe Kapler?
Yes.
You know, as you guys know, there is a lot of controversy surrounding Gabe Kapler. He allegedly covered up sexual assault in L.A. He has admitted that he could have handled it better. You know, I have mixed feelings on this. I met him last week at a meet and greet, and he seems like a really good guy. Now, it could be political, but at the same time, I'm willing to give him a shot. However, my morals, tell me what he did was a bad thing, though. I'm not a fan of this cancel culture, which is you screw up once, you have to go away forever.
Right.
Now, let's say it comes out that he broke the law. That's another thing.
So another person, though, out in your state, obviously, like Joe Maddon, is that reception good in L.A. or Anaheim, as we know it is?
I don't know. I mean, he was Mike Socha's bench coach from 2000 to 2006 and 2002 when the Angels gave Giants fans, if you want to rub a loss in Giants fans' face, one word, 2002.
Absolutely. And the funny thing is, and who was the coach for the Giants back then?
Dusty, who went and blew you guys a 3-1 lead the next year. Ha ha, two can play at this game.
Touche, my friend. Good job.
Even though I was cheering for the Cubs over the Marlins, because one, I wanted the Cubs to win their first title in 95 years, and two, the Marlins beat us, which was another horrible. That 0-3 right. Giants team, Pat, would have gone all the way if they got past the Marlins. I sincerely believe that. Bonds and Schmidt were having exceptional years, and I just don't think that team, they would have beaten the Yankees, too.
I think they would have gotten past. Yeah, I think they would have gotten all the way because you see what happened with a Dusty Baker-coached Cubs team. In 03, what happened is we had a great team, we had a great roster, we were hitting well, and then all of a sudden, hey, we're 5 outs away from the World Series, and here we go. A bobbled ball, no double play out of that, you have a couple of pass balls, you have the infamous Bartman ball to left field. So you have these breakdowns that have happened over the years, and I feel that the Cubs are, if they don't get things together here over this offseason, next year, they could be a great regular season team, very possibly win the division, but not go anywhere in the playoffs because they're not gelling together as a team should. I have that worry for them.
I do, too. I mean, I feel like with the current crop of young guys the Cubs have, they can compete for maybe anywhere between 2 to 4 more years. But if they want to win another World Series anytime soon and extend their future past, 21 to 23, they do need to get younger. There's no doubt about it. And that's why I think, I mean, you don't want to trade a guy like Chris Bryant, but that might be what it takes to avoid. And this is where the Giants really failed. The Giants did never thought of the future. And so they just like, okay, we're going to keep – we'll win it every even year with the crop we got, and then they got old in a heartbeat. Same thing happened in the 2000s. Oh, Barry Bonds is going to carry this team forever. Oh, Bonds gets hurt in 05, misses all but 14 games that year. And so you have to think future. And, well, Chris Bryant may be a face of the franchise, yet you don't want to run into a stretch where you're going to have, you know, 3 to 5 up to 10 straight losing seasons. So is trading Chris Bryant necessary? Absolutely.
Now, what about somebody like Nolan Arenado, who is coming up here that hasn't landed a team? You have
well, Arenado's extended.
Oh, they did extend him.
They extended him, I think, earlier this year. He's extended well into the 20s.
Well, because I know a lot of people were talking about recently that there could be a trade. Arenado could very well for a person like Chris Bryant. Would you trade up? And if the Cubs got Arenado for whatever reason, or another third baseman for whatever reason, are they as good as the first few seasons Chris Bryant was here? And that's the thing I think a lot of Cubs fans would definitely compare to.
I would say Arenado is an all-around better player than Chris Bryant. I mean, they're both great ball players, but Arenado is a guy who will probably be in his prime a couple of more years, because a lot of guys now that the steroid era is over, they're in their prime, and anywhere between 32 to 34 is when they go south. So I feel like, you know, it might help. Well, it might even give you a world championship in the next couple of years. But at the same time, it's not going to bode well for the future.
Yeah, I don't think so as well. I think our moves now. Teams' moves now, depending on, you know, obviously not like a Verlander or like a Garrett Cole or what have you. Teams' moves right now, to me, some of them, top-tier moves, are going to benefit these teams in the long run. Some of them are just Band-Aids right now that will fail in 3 years. So are we going to have so many teams brought up that are going to take advantage of this 3-year window? Or are we looking at teams that are going to fail hard and break their fans' hearts?
Well, I'm hoping for, I think what's a big factor is the tanking. If Major League Baseball can do something to tackle the draft, I think you'll see a lot of teams compete. That'd be great for baseball. I mean, right now I feel like 2020 is in a position, we're in a position right now at the end of 19 through the end of 20 where the power structure in baseball is about to change. It kind of changed in 16 and 17. It's about to change over here again in 19 and 20. And I think it depends. I think if they continue the current system, you're not going to see that many teams be that competitive, and they'll continue to break fans' hearts. If they're able to implement a draft lottery, then you will see teams be more competitive, take advantage of this 3-4 year window that you're talking about, and have some great entertaining baseball.
So the White Sox on the south side of Chicago here are trying to take advantage of making some key free agent decisions, maybe making some trades, trying to get pieces that have them competing further into the playoffs this year. And then you have
the White Sox.
Go ahead.
I know you're going to hate to hear this, Pat, but the White Sox are a team I kind of root for. They're the second city, second team. It's like I always root for the A's here in the Bay Area. I'm not an A's fan, but
we're about
because
to cut him off.
Second team.
We're about to hang up on him. I swear.
Man.
Ed,
he's a tough host, isn't he?
Oh, man, you guys are ruthless over there.
I don't know how he got that.
I think the White Sox will be competitive next year. I could see them contending for sure. And they haven't had a winning season since 2010.
Well, yeah, well, you have that. But then you also have things like Tim Anderson coming up. And you have Eloy Jimenez out there. And you have possibly Marcell Ozuna or a Nick Castellanos from the Cubs coming over to the White Sox this offseason. So you could possibly have good pitching, not great pitching, good pitching, and a great offense to back that up. And I think that is what the White Sox have needed, is a very consistent, good offense. Because
I think the pitching has
been there.
I think if they sign Ozuna, they'll win their division. I'm going to tell you that right now.
Where do the Twins fall? How do they fall down, and what do you see for them?
It will be a good division. I mean, I think the White Sox have some good young talent. The Twins do, and the Indians really restocked their farm system earlier this year with their trade at the deadline with the Reds. I think we're going to see for the next 5 years, we're going to see these three teams, the Twins, the Indians, and the White Sox, constantly duking it out for the American League Central. And even the Tigers in a couple of years could be competitive if some of their young guys can turn out to be well.
Well, why do you see the Indians, when the Indians very likely after this next year are going to be doling out a few of their key pieces, which if they don't get much back for these key pieces, how can we then say they're in the mix? Right now I see it a two-team race, White Sox and Twins.
Next year?
Absolutely.
Or you mean in the future?
No,
so you don't think the Indians
next year.
But, and you think the Indians are going to go down? I mean, the Indians, they restocked, they replenished their farm system with the trade with the Reds in July. So that's why I feel like, you know, kind of rebuild and stay competitive. They're going to dish off the old guard, and they have a good, they'll have a new good young crop of players that they can have to take their place. Will they be as great as the teams that have won them three straight division titles? I don't know, but I don't think they'll dominate like they did, but I think they'll definitely be in the mix the next few years.
And here we go to the NL Central. The NL Central, the death by a thousand cuts over the last couple of years for the Chicago Cubs. 1 year, they barely make a wild card game, and they get beat by the Rockies at home. Then they played a game 163 about 2 years ago with the Brewers, lost. Then played the Rockies, lost. And now last year, they didn't even make the playoffs. They were so bad there at the end. What is it that you see coming out of the NL Central this year? Are teams like the Cardinals going to win a division, or is Milwaukee going to steamroll the NL Central?
I think it's way too early to tell. I mean, I think I can tell you in more in detail when we get to February, when more guys are signed, when teams report to camp, you get a good sense of what the teams will look like going into the season. I think it's going to be a three-team race. I think it's going to be the Cubs, Cardinals, and Brewers like it was the last 2 years. I don't think the Reds, who have a bright future, are there yet. The Pirates, they're not going to be there. They had a horrible year last season. It depends. I think if it, I think it's going to be duked out, but it's going to be a duel between the Brewers and the Cardinals, with the Cubs being competitive and finishing in third place.
So Cubs in third, huh? Just like last year?
That's what I think. And then, or if it depends, if they can get a big name, then it could be first place. I think honestly, though, I'll tell you why they could win the division. When you see, it's like the same reason when when a team gets rid of someone that they don't like, they'll a lot of times play over their heads. And the Nationals are a good team. I think they'll be around for a while, but I think they really had something to prove without Bryce Harper. And I think
absolutely,
ever since Joe Maddon managed the way he did in Game 7 of the World Series, which I think was some of the worst managing in the history of the game,
absolutely,
I've sensed over the last 3 years a lot of frustration in that Cubs clubhouse with them. And I feel like with Rossi, who they played with, many of the guys were teammates with in 15 and 16, I could see him taking them to a division title. So actually, you know what? This is a three-team race.
Good. Well, I'm glad you admit that. But I do see, like you said, one big name could change the future of the Cubs organization for the better or for the worse. I mean, who knows? If that big name goes to St. Louis, if the big name goes to Pittsburgh or Milwaukee, then because even though Milwaukee just lost Grandal to the White Sox, if they get a big name, or a big name pitcher rather, then who knows? If Dallas Keuchel ends up being a lefty for the Sox, then I see the Sox possibly overtaking their division and having the Cubs miss out on theirs. And like you said, probably a third place team.
And what was I to say? The one thing, you know, I don't want to have happen to the Cubs is after finally winning their World Series to go back to their losing ways. I'd like to see them stick around for a while and be at least competitive every year for, you know, the next several years.
It was fun, you know, when they were winning and the country was excited for it. It was fun.
And I think it's safe to say that, actually, you know what? No, this was the greatest probably stretch in their organization was 1906 through 1908, but this was definitely the second greatest run in the history of their franchise. Five straight winning seasons, four straight should have been five straight playoff appearances, three straight NLCS appearances. I mean, this is definitely the best stretch the Cubs have had in over a century.
I agree with you.
Well, and here's the thing is in 03, they go to the NLCS, they lose in game seven. They go seven games against the Marlins. 07 and 08, they're the best team in baseball, basically, back-to-back years, and get swept in the NLDS both years. So you have teams that have been good teams in the regular season, but I feel like they're kind of the the Los Angeles Dodgers of, well, I would say of baseball, they're another team, but they're the LA Dodgers of then, because
of the Central.
Of the Central, because they had those winning ways in the season, and like Clayton Kershaw, just can't commit in the playoffs.
Well, one big factor, and the Cubs really haven't run into this yet, when you see a team do so great in the regular season and take in the playoffs, it's actually been the opposite the last few years with the Cubs, the Royals, Cubs, Astros, and Red Sox. Is a lot of times prior to 2015, when a team like absolutely obliterates their division and wins a division by 10 to 20 games, they're playing meaningless baseball in September. I mean, it's basically like late season spring training. And so once, and then you're all of a sudden thrown into a, you know, a 3 out of 5 series, you're not ready to go. Happened to the Giants in 2000, happened to the Giants in 03 against the Marlins. Giants went wire to wire in 03. They won the division by 15 and a half games. And then they lost in 4 to the Marlins. And in 2012 almost happened to the Giants. The Giants ran away with their division that year, won their division by, I think, 8 to 10 games. And then all of a sudden they're down 2-0 to Cincinnati. Now we know what happened next. But still, teams really lose their momentum and lose their edge. But what's weird is it hasn't happened over the last few years.
So the last thing that I wanted to ask you before we get out of here for the day is what do you think, or what teams do you think could get off to a good run right now as the teams sit now, not before any of these new free agents get signed and what have you, maybe trades happen, but for right now as we see it, and I know it's early, but since I have you on the show right now, I'm going to ask you, what is it that you see? What team could get on a run regardless of their preseason, regardless of spring training?
I think the White Sox for starters, the Cubs. I think in the National League West, it's going to be a three-team race, the Padres, the Dodgers, and the Diamondbacks. Diamondbacks are definitely a team. Diamondbacks are always a wild card, man. They're not wild card, like the wild card, but they're always – you never know what they're going to do. The Padres have gotten talent. I think the Padres are still a year away, but I could see them making a decent run, maybe being a year ahead of schedule. Giants, I don't think, are there yet. Perhaps even the Blue Jays with some of the young talent they have. Despite the season they had last year, maybe the Blue Jays will turn things around.
Absolutely. I agree. And again, Stephen, thank you so much for offering your input here. And thank you so much for calling in today to round out our 2-hour show here on WRLR 98.3 FM.
Pat, thank you so much, man. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Stephen.
Have a good day.
All right. Again, Stephen Ruderman, former writer for Around the Foghorn, fan-sided site, and also he is a baseball analyst extraordinaire, as I like to call him. Good buddy of mine from Periscope, the company that's owned by Twitter. They run a lot of live streaming services, and I am a competitor in the live streaming arena, I guess you would say, trying to bring my kind of sports enthusiasm and the show to Periscope, to Twitter, Instagram, everywhere you can find it. That is somewhere also you can follow me at Golden Voice WRLR on Twitter, Instagram, and Periscope. You can look up Golden Voice WRLR on YouTube as well. I have a YouTube channel. And if you're not already following, go ahead and follow and subscribe to the brand new WRLR 98.3 FM YouTube channel that I have created for the company or for the station. That is great. All the new pieces of content, when I get them, I format them, I put them up for you guys, and I'm looking forward to growing that channel with you as listeners.
Listen, I wanted to thank you, Pat. I've had just an absolute ball today. I want to thank WRLR 98.3, the voice of Lake County, for allowing me to sit in today. It's been a long, long time since I've sat in the studio, and boy, it's been a great time, and good luck with the show. You're doing a great job. Keep it up, my son. You're doing fantastic. I'm proud of you.
I really appreciate it. And again, next week, Norm and I will be back in studio.
Norm!
next week, December 18th, I believe, is the very next show. It's from 2 to 4 p.m. Central Standard Time, the Golden Sports Show here, 98.3 FM, WRLR, the voice of Lake County. I've been Pat Voss, and sitting in with me is my father, Ed Voss, the original Golden Voice of radio.
Oh, yeah.
We'll see you guys next week. We're going to be talking some great subjects. Keep up with me, again, Golden Voice WRLR on Twitter, so I can inform you of what's coming up for next week's episode and who our guests are going to be. We'll see you later.